In the mountains he replied, echoing their joyous strains. Sing it one more time. Angels, we have heard tonight, sweetly singing o'er the plains. In the mountains he replied, echoing their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo, gloria in excelsis Deo. Hallelujah. The newborn king, Bethlehem, see him whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knees, Christ the Lord, a newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Come on, worship him, Emmanuel, light of the world. In angels we have heard tonight, sweetly singing o'er the plains. And the mountains in reply, echoing their joyous strains.
Once again, lift it up.
In gloria, in excelsis Deo, gloria, in excelsis Deo, in excelsis Deo. Jesus is Deo.
Hallelujah. So wonderful to see you here. We're so grateful. I'm Nicole Cortez. I'm the Children's Ministry Director of Glad Tidings Church, and I'm so blessed to be here with you this Sunday. So let's worship together, and yeah, happy Sunday.
Let's praise him. Come on. Emmanuel.
Emmanuel, you're the God who saves us. You're worthy of all our praises.
Sing.
Emmanuel, oh Emmanuel, you come have your way among us. We welcome you here, Lord Jesus. We welcome you. Yes, we welcome you, have your way in our hearts, in our lives. Thank you.
His blood poured out for us, the weight of every curse upon Him. One final breath He gave as heaven away. The Son of God was laid in darkness. A battle in the grave, a war on death was waged. No power of hell forever broken. The ground began to shake. The stone was rolled.
We sing hallelujah, the Lamb is so overcome.
Part of the Christmas story is that the angels went to the shepherds in the fields that night that baby Jesus was born. And it's significant because in Psalms, the Lord says that we are his and he is ours, and we are the sheep of his pasture. The angels could have gone to anybody. They could have gone to the ocean edge, or they could have gone to the merchants, but they went to some shepherds up in the fields that were tending their sheep, because this was a precursor for us to understand that God is our good shepherd. In fact, Psalms 23 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." You know, the characteristics of a shepherd is that he leads, that he defends, and that he protects, and he provides. And so we're going to take an offering right now, and I want you to stand with me and declare that in this holiday season, that the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He's going to lead me, he's going to protect me, and he's going to provide for me. And you know, you can give online, you can drop it off in the mail, or even come by the church and drop off your tithe and offerings. But when we do that, we really are making a stand and saying that the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want, because he leads us. And you know, speaking of the holiday season, I do have a couple of events that I really want you to put on your reminder here. First of all, December 20th, next Sunday at the 9 and the 11, live here, we are going to do this Christmas story, the reacting of the whole story seen through the eyes of Mary. You really want to tune in, call your friends, tune in. You know, it's not Christmas unless we reenact the story of the birth of our Savior. And then also, December 24th is our Christmas Eve service. 6 p.m., wonderful service of celebrating the Christmas season. And then December 31st is our New Year's Eve service. And get this, it's at 11 p.m. because we're going to ring in the new year like we've never rung in the year before. And it's very significant that you tune in, because Pastor Schott is going to give us a prophetic word for 2021. And I don't know about you, but I am ready for a prophetic word for this new year. So don't forget to set your reminder, mark your calendar, call your friends, because December 20th, we're reenacting the Christmas story at 9 and 11. December 24th, we're doing the Christmas Eve celebration. And December 31st, you're going to get a word from God.
Well, praise the Lord. Isn't it great to serve God in these days? And you know, this is harvest time, a time when God is moving specially among the nations, and a great work is about to happen that perhaps we have never seen in such a proportion, as God will do it. Pastor has asked me just to give a little report of the things that God has been enabling Glad Tidings to do, even during this terrible COVID. And it's wonderful. We thank God for it. We want to think, first of all, of our missionaries that have been on the field for a time, and that Cindy Shador, and I believe we have some pictures to go along with this. Cindy, for many years, has preached the gospel and been a great missionary in Asia. And in the last years, she's been in Taiwan working with our people there. Many wonderful things happening. She has done a lot of work with the Aboriginal people and up in the mountains and just preaching the gospel and having Bible studies and prayer meetings. And then she also uses her English class as another way to present Jesus to many of those dear people. And we've seen God do some very wonderful things and the power of God. I believe it was just a short time ago that a lady there was feared to have cancer. And they prayed, and then she went for her test, and it came back benign. And oh, what rejoicing. And her unsaved husband, he couldn't stand it any longer. He had to get saved. And he gave his heart to Jesus and was baptized in water and now attends every service. Oh, what God can do. And he does it over and over again. And then we move on to South Asia. And there's Alan and Olga Miner. The COVID has closed the door to India for a while. So they have been relying on continued networking with the Christians online. They've been teaching their discipleship course and just encouraging the people in the Lord and even led a few souls to Jesus. Hallelujah. God is not limited, no matter what is going on around us in this earth. Oh, but let's move along to Israel. God has given us new opportunities to bless Israel with Pastor Pakhtar. He's a great pastor with a revival church of 400 in the city of Ashdod. And in Israel, 400 is a very large congregation for a revival church. And Pastor there is very experienced for many years. And he has a passion to win both the Jews and the Arabs to Jesus. Wonderful things are happening. And he has many outreaches to the new immigrants and to the some of the people that are on the streets, homeless. And outreach to the elderly and outreach to the children and all these outreaches. And here in Glad Tidings, both the trustees and the mission board all decided unanimously, let's help this man. And so he is getting $500 a month for 1 year from GT at this time. And I'll tell you, it's a wonderful thing what he's doing. But the second wave of COVID really hit Israel, and it really caused some concern about shortages, food shortages, and shortages in for the normal everyday life. And it also presented great problems to the elderly. Pastor Pakhtar was so concerned. And so our pastor, Shot here, had a great suggestion. He said, let's designate the December missions offerings to Israel. And we also included in that our sister church, the Chinese church that meets here, Amazing Grace. They're a part of the family of Glad Tidings now. And they really got behind this. They really, really love Israel. And they took offerings to the sum of $12,000. Praise God. This is in COVID time. Just imagine. Everybody sacrificed and gave and with a happy heart to help Israel. And so then GT, we had to rise up to, and we're going to make that up to $20,000 that we're going to be sending to Israel to help in this great time of this second wave of the COVID. Well, God didn't stop there. We move on to Liberia. another new mission field for us. And Pastor Schott was with Pastor Kamara there a while back, and he truly is a man of faith and prayer. And he has prayed for his country, and God has done wonderful things for him. He pastors a thriving revival church, and he also has many, many outreaches for evangelistic procedures. And it's been wonderful what God has done. He was trying to build a Christian school for the terrible plight of hundreds of children that just wander the streets aimlessly without God and without hope in Liberia. And of course, it was very difficult for him. So once again, GT responded and sent $6,000 to complete the building that he had begun, and another $1,800 to make sure it complied with all the government standards for a Christian school. So praise the Lord, God is on the move. And also there was a $3,000 donation to sponsor the first 15 students, and of course he needs more, so we need another 35 sponsors, but we're going to wait to January, and then we'll talk to you about that. I'll just let you know this so you can pray about it and ask God what he would have you do. To sponsor one child, it is only $200 for an entire year. And that includes their schooling, a hot meal every day for them, and a little uniform to put on. So praise God. We're going to believe God for wonderful things in that school. You know, Pastor Kamara told me in an email that he himself had attended a Christian school when he was just a boy. And he was a Muslim. And he came and heard about Jesus in the school. He got saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, and God called him to the ministry. You never know what God will do with any child. And so let's just be praying. Say, Lord, what part can I have in causing this great work in Liberia to proceed even further? Well, we better move along. We're going to India again for a moment or two. And there we meet Marina Khan. She has a big heart for the children that live in the slum area of Calcutta. She and her husband visited the area, and they were so stirred and so challenged that they said to each other, we've got to do something to help some of them in their deplorable state. And it is deplorable, the poverty that the slum children live in India. And I'm glad God has not forgotten them. And many are helping them, but there's so many children that need help yet. And so by faith, she, Marina and her husband, started what is called the Kolkata Shalom. And it was an area, first it started as just a makeshift canteen. And with that, they fed 60 children every day. And then they were able to secure a little bigger facility. And so now they feed 80 to 85 children every day. Praise the Lord. But more than that, and she's quick to tell you how wonderful it is to do that, but it's even more wonderful to bring them the gospel of Jesus Christ and to let them know God loves them and God has a plan for their little lives. And if they trust him, he will bring them out of such a deplorable state and bless them with his presence. And so this is their vision. And we wanted to help them. Incidentally, her husband was a new Christian, and he jumped in it with her. And as a matter of fact, he's the cook. He cooks all these meals for all these children. but he's so glad to do it as unto the Lord. And so we sent for her $2,000 that she can use to continue her good work. She also teaches and teaches sewing and all kinds of things that'll help even the parents, and even in handcraft and so on, that they can make a little bit of finance to look after their own children. And so this is the wonderful way the Lord works. And we believe and trust in him. Amen? Well, I say amen and amen. And so we want to pray for these people that are doing meaningful work for God. They've sacrificed. And we want to just join them in prayer and in do whatever God tells us to do. Well, lastly, we turn our hearts to Malaysia. And there are many jungle villages of Aboriginal tribes there. And we're going to tell you about a wonderful Christian there, Grace Lee. She was a former executive assistant, and she lives in Sitiawan, Perak. And after a real life-changing experience with God, she has such a passion now to reach souls for Jesus. And Grace used her own life savings to, together with her friends, open the children's home and a Grace study center for the children that are without hope in some of those villages. And she has rescued 27 teenage girls about the age of 13 from being sold in the sex slave over there. And if you can imagine that, she is one courageous woman. 27 that she has brought into her home, and now teaching them and feeding them and helping them to learn to live normal lives. What a wonderful opportunity to help her and to carry on the work of the Lord. And as those girls hear the message of Jesus and of his love for them, many of them turn to the Lord and their lives are changed. Grace also teaches domestic skills, music, cooking, etc. And this very courageous woman also ministers in local villages and travels to the remote areas of neighboring Indonesia. I tell you, we truly need to pray for all of these missionaries and their efforts, that God will abundantly bless them. And so even in this time of COVID, God is on the move. Let's move on with him. You know, when Jesus saw the multitudes, it said he was moved with compassion. And when we see and hear of all these needs, it should move us with compassion today and say, Lord, what do you want me to do? Where can I fit in the great plan of God for today? Jesus was moved with compassion, and he said, pray that the Lord of the harvest will send forth laborers into his harvest field. Hallelujah. We need to have heart for the harvest. Heart for the harvest. And you know, that will release the law of love within us. The law of love goes like this. It's not how many hours and how much must I struggle to seek the Lord for the lost. It's rather, Lord, give me more minutes in the day and more days in the week to call upon God and to seek the Lord with all my heart for the souls of people. The law of love is like this with giving, with ourselves. We dedicate ourselves to God. It's not how much do I have to give God of my life. No, it's what can I give God? How much can I give God of my life? I surrender all. Lord, just let us be a part of this great harvest and this great experience that God is giving to us, and opportunities to reach the world for Jesus. And we can fill our little part in doing this. And you know, God will bless every person that says, yes, yes, Lord. Not halfway, but all for Jesus. Remember, he went all the way to the cross. He suffered and died and bled and rose from the dead, all for our salvation. Now it's our opportunity to say, Lord, make me a harvester. Make me a winner of souls. Let me believe you and seek you and give it all to you, that you may be glorified in these last days. May God bless you.
Wonderful, beautiful, hallelujah, somebody. What have you been doing during COVID? Well, I want to tell you what Glad Tidings has been doing. We have been raising up missions again, hallelujah. I began to do some quick math in my head. Over the last couple months, we've given $35,000 to missions. Excuse me. Come on, somebody. Excuse me, hallelujah. Glory to God. And we have another $38,000 in the bank we want to sow to the mission field. What have you been doing? We've been getting stronger. Mission's been getting stronger. Worship's been getting stronger. Everything we're doing, the staff, the trustees are getting stronger. People are getting stronger. I had a man right before the service just come up to me and say, hey, Pastor, can I share something with you? And I said, yeah, tell me. He said, I got a raise. During COVID, you got a raise? And then the wisdom came on me. I said, don't tell your wife. Come on, somebody help me right now. Do not tell your wife, because she'll just say, thank you, big boy. Get out there and make some more money. God, during COVID. Today, I'm going to bring a real word to you. You can get stronger. All the resistance is what's making you stronger. I thank God for my childhood. I thank God for the struggles. I thank God for the challenges, because they made me stronger. And you're saying, my life is so difficult. It's so hard. Pastors, it's just impossible. Don't push away from it. Step into it. Right now, God's anointing is on Glad Tidings Church. During this season, we have grown in every way. We've grown financially. We've grown in love. We've grown in faith. We've grown in numbers. During COVID, we've got stronger and stronger. I'm going to have to give you a diagnosis. What has taken away your strength? The Bible says in 2 Samuel chapter 3 and verse 1, here's what it says. The war lasted a long time, and the house of David grew stronger, and the house of Saul grew weaker. You have to decide where you want to reside. What house do you want to be in? Do you want to live in a house of unbelief, doubt, fear, griping, complaining? Turn the news off at least for one day and turn on the good news of the Word of God. God says, I'm going to cause everything to work in your favor. I'm going to make a way where there wasn't a way. I even believe this, that God is going to wipe out the stupid Egyptians chasing you. It's going to be all right. You'll get strong if you'll hear the Word of God today. I had a strong impression as I was honored and privileged to be here with you today. You would say today, Pastor, I really have a heart for God, but God told me something. I heard it clearly. He said, tell them I have a heart for them too. You might have a heart for God, but God has a heart for you. He cares about every little detail in your life. He cares about everything that can distract you. He cares. He's the God of details. You know, we would go into the busy city, and I couldn't find a parking spot, and I go round and around and around. And then my crazy blonde wife with green eyes would say, is it okay if I pray? Pray. Come on. No, hon, I just want to pray. And I'd be just kind of pastorally impatient. Yeah, whatever, just pray. She said, Father, thank you. You care about every little detail in our life. And I thank you for a parking spot. Right then, a car would pull out, and there'd be a spot. I'm telling you, you have a heart for God. God has a heart for you. The little details of your life, God cares about. You know, when we came to this great, great church, and we came to this great city, it was new to us. Everything was new to us. And we began to thank God for every single little detail. Because when the natural things lined up, we could step into the supernatural. But when all the natural things are undone, you have troubles focusing on the supernatural. I want to let you know today, God is taking care of the little things. You've worried long enough. You've been afraid long enough. You've been fearful long enough. You've lived in unbelief long enough. You've been paranoid long enough. You've been in doubt long enough. Today, we're going to fill up some holes and level your life from the Word of God. Drone's going to lead us in one song, and I want you to open your hearts to Jesus right now. He's just going to lead us.
Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him. Oh, come, let us adore Him.
Make you stronger. You don't understand, Pastor. I cannot deal with this. No, God's going to make you stronger. But I'm crazy, Pastor. No, settle down. God can make you stronger. It says this in 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 1. There was a word to make a dirt farmer into the king of Israel. One word took him from the dirt farming to being the king of Israel. Look what it says in the Word of God. Samuel also said to Saul, "The Lord sent me to anoint you." It says this, "Now, therefore, heed the word of God." Listen to it. Thank you, Jerome, so much. Heed, stop, listen to the word of the Lord. If you want to grow stronger, you're going to have to stop and listen to the word of the Lord. That was the first thing that God spoke to Saul. He said, you've got to heed. The word heed means stop everything and to listen to what God has to say. Don't listen to everybody else. When I stopped and I heard the Lord, go to glad tidings, give everything you have to them, give them your heart, hallelujah, I stopped and heeded the word of the Lord. I didn't say, well, what's for me? And how about this? I didn't do any of those things. I didn't ask any questions. I just stopped. Today, if you want to get stronger, you're going to have to stop. Whatever God's telling you to do, you're going to have to stop and heed the word of the Lord. Look, verse 8, it says. It says, he took Agag alive. This is very important you hear this. What is God? This is going to get a little heavy. I'm going to tell you in advance, get a little heavy, because we got too many weak Christians, too many weak leaders, little pastors that couldn't lead anybody. Business people are falling apart. Families are falling apart. Why? God gave them a word, take Agag out. He was beyond evil. We had a cousin when I was a little boy, and he was evil. He was dangerous. And my family said, we can't have him come over. There was things that he did that were off the chart. And we couldn't let him be around little girls. He was dangerous. And I remember my aunt yelling at my mom, you think you're better than us. You think you're better than us. But the real issue wasn't we were better. The real issue is we didn't want that around us. Better hear it. God says, take this crazy thing out of your life. And look what the word says, verse 8. But they took him alive. They let him live. What has God told you in his word and in your heart? Get rid of it. Get rid of it right now. And you haven't. And that thing's going to kill you. That's why you don't have strength. God said, get rid of it. Now, I'm not preaching on tobacco. You girls that chew it, that's between you and your teeth. I'm not preaching on cigarettes. I'm not preaching on alcohol. But there was one family, he was a pastor. And all of his family members were severe alcoholics. And their behavior, they were from Sicily. And when they drank alcohol, they always became extremely violent. And I didn't preach on it. But he cornered me, him and his wife. They were traveling evangelists. And he kind of tried to yell at me, which is a bad move. And he said about the alcohol, well, tell me where in the Bible it says I can't drink alcohol. Even Jesus turned the water into wine at the end of the party. I didn't say a word. All I said, what is God telling you? Well, he was mad and he was this, but God had spoke to him. I heard him say, for you, son, you can't have alcohol because it'll make you crazy. It'll make you violent. It'll make you immoral. You cannot have any. God had spoke to him, but he wanted to go through me. And I said, what did God say to you? I don't want to be involved in this. But he was really angry with me. I was going to Mexico to do a conference crusade. And I was in the Phoenix airport. And it was very, very busy, and we were waiting for our plane. We're about a half an hour out to go down to Mexico. And I saw him walking in the airport, which is nearly impossible to recognize anybody. Everybody's moving so quickly. And I said, hey, good to see you. How are you doing? He said, not very good. I said, huh? Not very good. Now, this guy traveled with me to Fiji. We did crusades there. God had used him in a powerful way. I said, are you okay? He said, no, I'm not okay. I said, do you have my phone number? I said, I'm going down to Mexico. When I get back, call me. He said, okay, when will you be back? I told him. I come back and he calls me. He said, I'm completely wiped out. My wife divorced me. My kids won't have anything to do with me. I said, what happened? He said, well, there was a wedding, and I had a little too many, and I stepped over some lines, and my wife said, I cannot live with this. And I began to think about Agag. What is God telling you to get rid of? This is not legalistic preaching. I don't care about some stupid tattoo. Just make sure she's the right girl. And you spell her name right, and then go ahead and slap that thing on your neck. Who cares? We're not talking about legalism. I'm talking about what has God told you to get rid of. God has spoken to Pastor Jody and I about certain things. We will not do it. And it's not even in the scripture. God told us, do not do these things. And we're not going to do it. Because Agag will kill you. His voice, his influence, speaking to you, speaking to your children, speaking to your grandchildren, speaking to leadership. His mouth was seductive. And because his mouth was seductive, he constantly brought strife, immorality, and horrible things. And then it says in the Word of God, they took Agag alive. But God told them to kill it. Look at the next thing that made Saul weak. Verse 11. It says, greatly regret. Huh? Greatly regret. I have some regrets in my life. How about you? I have some things I wish I never would have done. I've had some relationships I knew better than to get into with different people. I have regrets. But if the prophet of God said, I greatly regret that I made you king. I greatly regret that I gave you your business. I greatly regret that I prospered your family. I don't want God to ever be able to say that about me. And that was the word now, because he didn't heed the first word. I'm preaching a little hard today. Someone say, go ahead, it's Christmas. Hallelujah. We're just putting some people, we're just cooking the turkeys right now. Hallelujah. That's what we're doing, turning up the heat. Hallelujah. But there's things that God is telling you. You can't do it. I will never, ever, ever, under any circumstances, be alone with a woman. No woman can come and meet me behind closed doors, no matter what. Well, Pastor, what are you talking about? I'm too good looking. Come on, somebody yell at me. I'm way too good looking. I'm not going to subject myself to gossip and lies. I'm doing a major crusade in Mexico, and a girl came and picked me up. Drove up in the car to pick me up to drive me to the crusade. I said, I can't go. She said, well, Pastor, what's wrong? Why you can't come? I'm not coming. Well, why? Because God told me. Even though everybody, my sign is all over the city and all, I am not coming because I'm not getting in the car with you. She said, well, did I do anything wrong? It's nothing to do with you. It's what God told me. God told me I can never be in a closed room with a woman. It's just God spoke to me. And I'm not going to violate what God says. I'm going to heed the word of the Lord. And a lot of us haven't heeded the word of the Lord. And now all of our strength is gone. All of our credibility is gone. All of our future is gone. Today, I want you to stop. What has God told you to do? Not some preacher, not some creed, not a church. What has God told you to do? You better heed it. You better listen to it. So they quickly called, and I was late for the crusade, but they showed up with five girls, and that's all right with me. And they all went in a van and said, come on in, Pastor. We'll rush you to the crusade. I did what God said. Right here it says, I greatly regret. Look what it says, verse 11. I greatly regret that I made you king. You know, I never want to disappoint God. I don't want God to say, I greatly regret that I made you the senior pastor of Glad Tidings. I don't want that to happen. I don't want God to look at your business and say, I greatly regret, I'm trying to smile right now because this isn't overly fun, that I blessed you, I prospered you, I gave you your wife, I gave you your children, I gave you your opportunities. Somebody better take notes. What has God told you to do? I don't have any strength, Pastor. I don't have any faith, Pastor. I don't know what's going on, Pastor, but what has God told you to do? I remember we didn't have enough money to get a building. I remember everything was tight. We're stuck in a gymnasium. The Lord led me to start this church. We've got about 400 people, but we still don't have the resources. And we had a sum of money saved up. It wasn't much, but it was a sum of money. And the Lord said to me, I want you to give the whole thing to the mission field. And I said to the Lord, because I'm a thinker, I said, well, what will we have for our building? And the Lord spoke to me, you don't have enough for a building. Well, what are we saving the money for? You don't have enough. But I'm more than enough, Vince. I am more than enough. Just do what I tell you to do, because I am more than what you have. God's speaking to me. I heeded the voice of the Lord. I went to the leadership and I said, I think we need to sow this money. They said, I've been feeling that too, Pastor. Are we in agreement? We just sowed it all. Now we have nothing. But we have God. We have God. I get a phone call 6 months later from a pastor. He said, the Lord spoke to me about you in a dream and told me to give you our church. That was 35 years ago. We'd still be saving and wouldn't have enough. What God did was multi-million dollars, turned it over to us. What's God asking you to do? You're worried about this and worried about that. All your strength is gone. Greatly regret. And then verse 12, they said, where is Saul? Oh, he's making, building monuments to himself. I don't care. It was really funny. This is kind of funny, but someone on the staff accidentally called me one of the previous pastors' names. And I laughed. They were so embarrassed. Oh, they're falling apart. Oh, no, I called them by the wrong name. Oh, no, I don't know. I could ever look at them again. I just laughed at them. I said, I call my wife the wrong name sometimes. Don't worry about it. She calls me Vance sometimes. Don't even worry about it. And I just giggled. And I said to God, I really don't matter. And meant it. I really don't matter. What matters is you, Jesus. What matters is Vince Schott obeys Jesus. What matters is I love and honor Jesus. What matters is I give everything I have to glad tidings and the people of God. And if they never remember my name, God, I trust they'll know your name because you changed their life. You see, Saul was a dirt farmer chasing donkeys. And now all of a sudden he thinks he's something. Rather than obeying God, what God was telling him to do, he was building monuments to himself. Don't you know that every 40 years, a revolution comes up and they pull down all the monuments? Don't you know what teenagers do to monuments and statues? Don't you know by now what they do? You build some monument to yourself, all they're going to do is graffiti you. The only thing that matters is Jesus. Hallelujah. I want you to resign today from your position, from your business, from being a trustee, from being a pastor, and I want you to give the title back to the one that matters, God Almighty. The reason that we don't have strength anymore is because we're so busy building up our case of who we are, our resume, but I got a resume that will never fail. It's the resume of God Almighty. Hallelujah. His name, he said, if I be lifted up, I'm going to tell you what God's going to do at Glad Tidings. Hundreds of people are come. Glory's going to fill the house. People are going to be born again, saved. People are going to be baptized. People are going to dance, sing, and shout. Prophets are coming to the house, and they'll go, who's that, Pastor? I don't know. All I know is Jesus is in the house. No more monuments to ourselves. I said no more monuments to ourselves. God's about ready to replace people. Don't have God come with a prophet. I regret I let you be on the team. I regret I gave you that position. I regret I gave you your husband. I regret. Woo! Don't come to me. He's weak because all of his energy is spent building his case up. I heard the voice of the Lord. Shut up. God talks to me that way. Shut up. It's the only way that you can stop me with my flapping mouth is for God to just flat out say, shut up. Just shut up. I said, well, what? I'm not sinning. I'm not. I gave my wife money. And I heard the voice of the Lord, just be quiet. Wow. And I didn't pout. I said, yes, sir, sir. Hallelujah. You thankful today? Verse 13. The prophet comes and stupid Saul says this. Oh, blessed are you, prophet of God. Fake. It's fake. I know people who smile at church. They do their little jig. They give a little tiny money. They say, hallelujah. Oh, God is good. Isn't he wonderful? And then in their car on the way home, they hate everybody in the church. It's called fake. It's fake. You'll love Pastor Jody Ann. She'll never, ever talk behind your back. She'll rip you up to your face. Come on, somebody help me out right now. She'll just tell you had better shape up. I'm giving you the count of 3, 2, 1. You better change your mouth, change your heart, change your life because there's a real God. Hallelujah. Fake. He became a fake. How many fake Christians do you know? How many times you've said it with your mouth, but it's not in your heart anymore? You've been wondering why you're so weak. You're a fake. You're a phony. President Trump did say one good thing. Fake news. A fake broadcast. Glad Tidings isn't fake. Hallelujah. We're going to give thousands of missions. We're not talking about, oh, the missionaries. Way off yonder doing the Lord's work. No! Pastor Israel Pakhtar said to me, everybody wants a photo shot. Everybody wants to put our picture up in their church about, oh, bless Israel. You're the church that puts money where your mouth is. We sent them $20,000 US. And I want to just let everybody know, an amazing grace led the way. I want to say that. An amazing grace beat us up and led the way. Holly, I want to say that'll never happen again. I want somebody to help me. That'll never happen again. I had to tell a beautiful, amazing grace, you are Chinese, you are not Hebrews. Hallelujah. They are wonderful. They led the way. Hallelujah. But the good news is, hallelujah, my church is Amazing Grace. When things don't go well at Glad Tidings, I'm a part of Amazing Grace Church. When things don't go well at Amazing, I'm the senior pastor of Glad Tidings. I'm either going to win or win. Hallelujah. Then here's what the prophet said, verse 16. Whew, this is not good. 1 Samuel chapter 15 and verse 16. Here's what the prophet said. Be quiet. Be quiet. Every one of these encounters was an opportunity for Saul to get his strength back. Every one of them. Be quiet. He said, be quiet. Verse 17, look what it says. When you were small. I'm going to say this to you right now. Get small. Get small. Get small. God, everything I have is because of you. Everything that's good in my life is because of you. I don't think I'm a big deal here at Glad Tidings. I really don't. I think it's the honor of my life. Don't think I can pull this thing off. Don't think I can turn this thing around. Do not think that. I am not a superstar. I was the only child that couldn't speak in front of people, that every time I spoke in front of people, I began to cry. And the kids in the classroom laughed at me. I went and beat them up. Maybe I'll beat you up. But I am a nobody, nothing that doesn't deserve to stand in this great pulpit, and I haven't forgot it. And there's an unusual anointing on this house, and I get to be a part. But I don't want God to regret that he brought me to Vancouver. I want to be quiet. How about you? And I want to stay small. Verse 18, it says, the Lord sent you on a mission and you didn't do it. You told God if he blessed your business, you said, I'll give 5% more to missions, and you haven't done it. You're looking to get a bigger house. Nothing wrong with a bigger house. But you're looking for what you can get rather than the what you promised God. Then this is when it gets crazy, verse 20. But I did obey. No, you didn't. What's the sheep I hear? But I did obey. Pastor, I'm in church and I'm this and I'm that. No, obedience is doing everything God tells you to do with a heart of humility. Verse 22, obedience brings the blessing of God. You can have a lot of things and prestige. You can. But do you have the peace of God in the storm of COVID? Do you have strength in COVID? During this pandemic, are you able to say, this is hard, this is difficult, but I know my Redeemer lives. I know God's hands on me. I know God is with me. You see, old Pentecostal preachers used to preach about things that don't matter. They would talk about the movie house. They'd preach about tobacco, the things that don't matter. Today, this old Pentecostal preacher is preaching on things that matter. Obey God, and you'll have strength. If you will obey God with your heart, I'm not telling you you won't fail, fall down, have an attitude, get crazy. I'm not telling you that. You're going to have moments, you're going to be a nut. Get a hold of yourself and say, God, I'm wrong. And have the strength of the house of David rather than the weakness of Saul. Verse 23, young people, listen to this. It says, rebellion is the sin of witchcraft. You don't know. And no one's going to preach this and tell you this. When you rebel, demonic forces come on your life. It's a fact. It's in the Bible. Every time. What was the first rebellion? It was Satan wanting to do his own gig, sing his own songs in heaven. It was rebellion, which is what? Witchcraft. When we rebel, you rebel against your parents, you rebel against spiritual authority, what happens is you invite demonic forces. Nobody's preaching this. It's a fact. Demonic forces. Well, Pastor, I want to know right now, can a believer be demon-possessed? Well, I don't know about that. All I know is they can be oppressed, heaviness. There's too many crazy Christians. Too many people are down and out. There's a demonic attack because what? We rebel. We rebel. Hallelujah. Verse 24, he feared man. He feared man. He's strong. I'm not afraid of anybody. You're afraid of people if you always have to be right. I made a real stupid decision, a quick one. I did. Just a quick one. It wasn't evil, but I said, so I'll do this and do this. And it cost money we should have never spent. It was a little bit of money. But I didn't say, well, I'm the leader, and I just said, that was stupid of me. Hallelujah. I wasn't thinking. Just quickly own it. Just own it in your heart. Today is a little rough, or is it? You don't have any strength. You don't have any peace. You can't see a future. I don't want that for you. Whatever God's telling you, do it now. Do it right now. Fear man. Verse 27, it says he tore the prophet's robe. The prophet turned around and said, the kingdom has been torn away from you. Don't grab it. Let go of everything. Let go of your bitterness. Let go of your anger. Let go of your opinion. I'm telling you right now in the name of the Lord, let go of it so God doesn't rip it from you. Everything that I have belongs to him. Everything that I do is for his honor and glory. I want to pray with you. This is a strong word today, but I'm responsible to have you not bleed to death. I'm responsible to make sure you fulfill what God has for you. I'm responsible for glad tidings, for world missions, for worship that touches the very throne of God. Jerome's going to come and join me, but I'm just going to pray for you right now. You see, heed the word of the Lord. With your heart today, say, Father, thank you. This word's come forth in the areas of my life. Lord, I thank you in the wonderful name of Jesus. God, anything in my life, tell him anything in my life you want to change. Any direction that I'm going that doesn't honor you, God. Anything that I say that doesn't bring glory to your name. Lord God, I surrender my life to you. I surrender my will to you. I surrender my heart to you, Jesus. I give my life to you. Anything that doesn't please you, I want to please you, Jesus. Come on, tell him now. I just want to please you. I just want to honor you, Jesus. Come on, soften your heart right now. Hallelujah. None of us are perfect. Nobody's perfect. Nobody does the right thing, the smart thing, the best thing all the time. Nobody. Nobody. Nobody does. I don't. But your heart can be perfect. Now, David did some really dumb things. Really, really high-level dumb. But his heart was perfect towards God. And God never rejected him. God never said, you did this and this and this. He always found a place to use David's life. He always found a place to use your life. If today the games can stop, the charade can stop, the pretending can stop, just say to Jesus, here I am, Lord. I just want to please you, Jesus. I want you to use my life. A little nobody from a nowhere town that didn't have a home and a family. God, I'm a nobody who met somebody named Jesus. Use my life. Every trustee, just lift your hands wherever you're at and say, God, use us. Use my life. Every staff member, lift your hand. Just say, God, use our life. Every usher, use our life. Every giver, use our life. Every servant, just use our life. Use this house. And don't say, I regret that I raised you up. heed your word. Whatever you want us to change, we'll change. We want to honor you, Jesus. We want to please you. And I thank you for a revival that no man can start and no man can stop at Glad Tidings Church, 3456 Fraser Street. Move afresh. In Jesus' name.
Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you, my Lord. Just to be close to you. It's a mighty sign. Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you. Just to be close to you. It's a mighty sign. I'll do anything. Just to be close to you. Just to be close.
We want to tell you right now that we love you. We're so proud of you. What a joy Glad Tidings has been. How impressive you've been with the hearts of the people, sweetheart.
Oh, this has been the time of my life. These are incredible people, and you just know that God is up to something. He's doing something awesome, and everybody feels it, and everybody senses that God is about ready to do something amazing, and there are some incredible people that are backing us and helping us just prepare the way.
Yeah. Next week, we're going to announce what trustee we like the least.
Oh,
that's what we're going to do
not
next
me.
Week, everybody.
Not
Come
me.
On, everybody.
Not me. I'm
Hallelujah.
Not. No, no, no.
And what staff member is our least favorite? So we're going to have some real fun.
So hey. If lightning comes down.
Come here. Oh, you guys are wonderful. You have treated us with ultimate respect, and I know it's because of Jesus. I want to thank the team that's here. Sid, Lorna, Josh Enns, you've never operated with such strength, stepping it up. Being God brought you home. It's good to have you at home. Hallelujah. Dylan's been wonderful. Peter's been wonderful. Hallelujah. Everybody here. Paul came in and helped today. Everybody. We're in this thing together. Hallelujah. This ministry right now, I want to let you know that it's going around the world.
Amen.
It's not because of us. It's because of this house. You see, God's hand is still on Glad Tidings for some reason. He's not finished with her yet. I want you, every one of you, to realize it's an honor and privilege for you to be a part of this. For those of you that just got pushed away, you wandered off, I want to make an announcement once again. This is a house of praise and worship. The Holy Ghost can interrupt anything I have to say in any service we have. There's going to be a heaven pouring into this place. God's going to do what we never thought he could do. We said he could do it. We wanted him to do it. Mm-hmm. But now Jody Ann and I can say we know for a fact because we have been in this move.
Yes.
He is going to do it. Hallelujah. And I get to be a part.
And we're so grateful. We're so very grateful that God hasn't forgotten his ultimate plan. And you know that he would even allow us to be part of it.
Yeah.
It's crazy, isn't it?
Hallelujah. And the one that called me by the wrong pastor's name, I want to let you
just
know
let
I still
go.
Love
just
you. Hallelujah. I still love you. My name is Pastor Vince Schott. Hello. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, this is a great time. This might seem awkward, but it's not. All of those at home, put your hands forward right now. Jody Ann and I are going to put our faith with your faith. We're going to declare the blessing of the Lord over you right now. Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray for divine protection through the element of wisdom. Protect your people in the name of Jesus. Lord, I thank you for provision. Father, these people are in covenant with you, and you are going to provide for them. I declare it in the name of Jesus. And then your mind wants to go on the dark side. I declare right now in the name of Jesus, the peace of God that surpasses understanding be on you in Jesus' mighty name. We love you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Can't wait to see you on Wednesday. Hallelujah. God bless you.
God bless.